Half a day, students. My name is Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. As we battle this COVID-19 outbreak, I want you to know that together, Governor Liu and I are working very hard to do everything within our power to keep our island safe from COVID-19. In addition, we have been working closely with the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam to bring you continuous educational curriculum while you stay home during this time. With that said, Governor Liangguero and I want you to remember to stay safe. This means listening to your parents. Wash your hands for at least 20 seconds and wash your hands frequently. Together, we will get through this. To our parents, the governor and I know how important it is that we stay diligent in our efforts to keep our students of Guam healthy and safe. Thank you for stepping in with your child's education during this time. I would also like to thank each and every member of the Guam DOE team, teachers and support staff, for their hard work, boundless energy, and for their commitment to our students of Guam. To our students, we hope that you enjoy PBS University while at home. Have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by the Guam Department of Education, PBS Guam, and in conjunction with public school teachers to create lessons that students will be able to easily follow. With the aim of helping students continue their learning at home, providing both parents and students with a unique educational experience. PBS University on PBS Guam.
Half a day, my name is John Fernandez, Superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. I want to begin by thanking you all for staying home and staying safe during the current COVID-19 pandemic. Let's continue to do our part by practicing good hygiene, social distancing, and staying home. I know it's not easy, but we can do this. Remember, we are all in this together. I know you understand why we had to close schools down for the rest of the school year, and I want you to know that your safety, the safety of your families, and the safety of employees come first. But let's not give up on teaching and learning. As you know, we have already provided a set of distance learning resources that are now on our website at www.gdoe.net. Now we're taking it to the next level with the help of Guam Public Broadcasting Service, better known as PBS. We will be launching PBS University, which will contain televised weekly lessons developed by our teachers and staff for students from K-12. These will be simple but effective lessons for students to work on at home, and they will include lessons in reading, math, and character development. These lessons will be updated weekly for the remainder of the school year and into the summer. Students, here's your opportunity to keep your mind sharp while you're stuck at home over the next few weeks. And parents, I hope that this will assist you in providing your children with dedicated instructional time and support. I want to close by just thanking those people on the front lines of the COVID-19 fight, our healthcare professionals, including our very own DOE school nurses and social workers, our law enforcement professionals, including our very own DOE student attendance officers and school resource officers, our principals and school staff, who along with Sodexo employees serve 24,000 school meals to feed our island's children, our food and nutrition employees, who are delivering food supplies to our nonprofit and government partners to assist needy families, and our teachers and staff who have worked hard to make distance learning a reality. Finally, a message to students, keep a positive attitude, keep learning, we miss you, and we'll see you soon in the new school year. Siduus maasi, and stay safe.
Half a day, welcome back to another episode of PBS University. Today, I'm your host, Mr. Shipman. Oh, thank you guys, thank you. What a wonderful, warm welcome. I appreciate that. Thank you very much. I want to give a shout out to my Wildcats out there. Thank you for watching. I know you are. And I guess we have to talk about the quarantine haircut that I got. Mm-hmm. You guys see that? Yeah. I got a mohawk. My sister, Mi Hermana, did it, and it was pretty cool. I like it. I think it's a great time.
Quick question.
Yes.
What about your beard?
Well, thank you, Rachel. That's a great question. I like it, and I'm going to keep it. So, yeah, let's go with that. The haircut's the only thing that I have, the only stereotype I've given into so far. I have not gained the quarantine 15. I know it looks like I'm bigger, it looks like I'm fatter, but that's because TV, man, the camera, it adds 20, 30 pounds easy. Not because I'm eating all my snacks. That's not it. It's the camera's fault. Anyway, enough about me. I got a question for you guys. How many of you have seen this picture? This image and images similar to it have been floating around the internet. You've seen it on Instagram. You've seen it on Facebook. You haven't seen it on Facebook. That's for old people like me. No, I'm hip. I'm young. I have a mohawk. So I'm definitely not on Facebook. But it's out there. You've seen them. And today what we're going to do is we're going to learn how to solve them. And how we're going to do that is by using math. All right. That's pretty cool. I like it. And one of those things, how we're going to use, how we're going to solve it by using math is called order of operations. Wait, let me try that again. Order of operations. See, much better, right? I know you like that. So, let's get to it.
Yeah. Vocabulary. Order of operations. Now make sure you follow step by step. Follow me. I've been first and I've been last. Either way, I keep the order with pen pads. First is parentheses, then it's exponents. Multiply, divide, add, subtract. Yeah, you know this. I've been first and I've been last. Either way, I keep the order with pen pads. First is parentheses, then it's exponents. Multiply, divide, add, subtract. Yeah, you know this. When I evaluate expressions, have some patience. I just follow the order of operations. I simplify to see what they equal. Pem comes first and DAS is the sequel. Pem DAS, yeah, that's an acronym. We'll break it down just to see what is happening. P is parentheses, search for them first. Whatever is inside them, you need to do the work. E is exponents, so raise them up. Or get down with the roots like Questlove does. MD, multiplication and division. I do them left to right, yes, that's my decision. AS, addition and subtraction. You learn them first, do it last. That is the fashion. Some say please excuse my dear Ron Sally. Some say PEMDAS. Either way, the order is important, just like swim class. I've been first and I've been last. Either way, I keep the order with PEMDAS. First is parentheses, then it's exponents. Multiply, divide, add, subtract. Yeah, you know this. I've been first and I've been last. Either way, I keep the order with pen gas. First is parentheses, then it's exponents. Multiply, divide, add, subtract. Yeah, you know this. Okay, okay, let's say that we've got this. Let's use PEMDAS, see what we accomplish. First we do what we see in the parentheses. 17 minus 15, that is 2 indeed. 3 plus 1, that is 4, yes I'm brilliant. Now, exponents is what we'll be dealing with. 4 to the second means 4 times 4, that equals 16. And yes, I'm sure. Next we multiply and we divide. 16 times 2 is 32. Oh my. 32 divided by 4 is 8. And then we add or subtract, okay? 8 minus 5 is 3. Which is easier than writing this to me. Cut through your operations just like a surgeon. Flow cat. Yeah, we keep it working. I've been first and I've been last. Either way, I keep the order with PEMDAS. First is parentheses, then it's exponents. Multiply, divide, add, subtract. Yeah, you know this. I've been first and I've been last. Either way, I keep the order with PEMDAS. First is parentheses, then it's exponents. Multiply, divide, add, subtract. Yeah, you know this.
Man, I love that song. So good. Just makes you want to, right? I know. All right, so order of operations. Like the video said, we start with parentheses. Okay, from parentheses, we go to exponents. That's the number with a smaller number on top of it. Then we have to solve multiplication and division. We always work from left to right. And then we have addition and subtraction. And again, we always solve from left to right. Then that'll give you your answer. So let's take a look at our picture.
Okay, we have 4 lines. We're gonna take each line one by one. Line 1, pair of shoes plus a pair of shoes plus a pair of shoes equals 30. We're gonna do the math and we're gonna figure out that pair of shoes is 10. 10 plus 10 plus 10 equals 30. Line 2 shows us a man, plus a pair of shoes equals 20. We already know that a pair of shoes is 10. We're going to figure out that a man is 5. 5 plus 5 plus 10 equals 20. Line 3 shows us a pair of straps plus a pair of straps plus a man equals 13. We already know that a man is 5. We're going to figure out that a pair of straps equals 4. 4 plus 4 plus 5 equals 13. Okay, next, line 4, the one that we have to solve. First of all, they only show us one shoe, but we know that a pair of shoes is 10. So a pair of shoes is 10, one shoe is 5. So we have 5 plus a man. But this man has a pair of straps and a pair of shoes. A man is 5, a pair of straps is 4, a pair of shoes is 10. So we have to write our equation like this. So we have 5 plus our parentheses. Next, we have only one strap. We know that a pair of straps is 4. So that means one strap is going to be 2. So we have 5 plus our parentheses times 2. Now we have to do order of operations. First, parentheses. So 5 plus 4 plus 10 equals 19. We don't have any exponents, so we don't have to worry about that. Next is multiplication and division. 19 times 2, always go left to right, is 38. Again, no division. Addition, 5 plus 38 equals 43. Ta-da! Boom, you got this.
Boom, easy peasy, right? Now go out there. Find those pictures, test your friends and family, and when they can't figure it out, you get to drop the mic on them. Huh? I like it? I know, right? That's pretty cool. All right, that's it for me. Stay safe, and until I see you again, keep rocking that quarantine haircut. Sweet.
Hey team, welcome back. It's Mr. Gibson here. It's so great to see you again. So, we have a lot of news going on, especially in Guam. Heard anything? Anything catch your attention? Well, something did for me. So, a few weeks ago, Governor Leon Guerrero released her recovery plan detailing how she's gonna reopen the economy. Featured in Governor Leon Guerrero's Salen Para Hinemlu slideshow was the word immunity, something I think hasn't been that prevalent in discussion regarding COVID-19. So, I wanted to discuss that today using a video and a poem. So, like all my videos, I'm gonna need you to break out some paper. One for a KWL chart, and another for something called TPCast. We'll get there later. But first, we're gonna do a chart. It's called a KWL chart. You are going to fold a sheet of paper into three. Don't worry if they're not even, we're not looking for perfection. On one column, you'll write no. What do you already know about the topic? In the middle column, you'll write want. What do you want to know about this topic? Last, you'll write learn. What did you learn about the topic? This KWL chart will be used for us to annotate as we watch the next video. As the video is playing, take some notes on some unfamiliar vocabulary words, how they're used, and how they might help us understand what the video is talking about. Now, in the video, we'll be looking at what immunity actually is and what vaccines actually do. Here are a couple of new vocabulary words we should become more familiar with. Immunity, a condition of being able to resist a particular disease. Virus, agent that can cause infectious disease. Co-evolve, to evolve at the same time. Vaccine, a substance that helps protect against certain diseases. Replicate, produce an exact copy of something. Now, on your KWL chart, if you're a little bit unfamiliar with them, you should write them down in the want to learn section. If you know them, write them in the know section. You can access this video on pbslearningmedia.org.
To understand how vaccines work, we first need to understand immunity. Sir Gustav Nossel is a world-renowned immunologist.
Immunity is a wonderful natural defense system of the human body. It depends on the white cells of the blood to rapidly get you protected against the disease.
Imagine millions of immune cells, such as white blood cells, all on the lookout for specific germs.
If they spot something foreign, like flu, they prepare to fight.
When that flu bug enters your body, the white cells like to move in on it, and they get a bit angry.
The immune cells arm themselves, and then replicate, creating an army of clones. Then, launching powerful germ-seeking agents called antibodies, they tag the germs for disposal. Once the germ is removed, the immune army disbands. But they leave behind memory cells. Their job is to remember the invader and to sound the alarm if it ever appears again.
When we're born, we're not yet very mature in terms of our immune system. So if an infection strikes a little infant, then there's a great vulnerability. It's the tiniest ones that need the most protection.
The recommended vaccine schedule is designed to close this window of vulnerability.
Some people believe that you don't need to vaccinate your child because you've got such a beautiful and good immune system. They forget that these bugs that surround us have been co-evolving with us, sometimes for millions of years, and in some respects, they're cleverer than us. They have worked out ways of evading the immune system unless you pre-arm it. So, putting it bluntly, the white cells mightn't be fast enough or smart enough if we hadn't whipped them along by a prior immunization.
A vaccine, in effect, sends in an imposter, a weakened or dead part of the germ, just enough to be recognized. The immune cells mount the defense. Because the threat is low, they quickly disband. But the all-important memory cells have been created. The immune system is now prepared for the real germ. To arm our immune system against multiple germs, different vaccines can be combined. This reduces the number of shots we need, and studies show it to be safe.
What we have seen in the industrialized world is essentially all of the major epidemics. They've vanished. Mums today have every expectation that their beautiful little baby will live and not be polished off by diphtheria, by tetanus, even occasionally by measles. Now that is the transformation in young lives that vaccines have wrought.
Now, while you're finishing off some of your notes, maybe you could start thinking about what the main idea of the video is about. If we can sum up this entire video, we can look at how immunity is a defense system against viruses, diseases. White blood cells use their memory to make sure our bodies are prepared for the next infection. Vaccines are important because viruses can grow with us over time and can sometimes be stronger. A vaccine's job is meant to keep our immune system in check. What have you heard about vaccines for COVID-19? Now, let's move over to the poem. Sometimes it's easier to look at scientific terms using figurative language. Today, we'll be working with a poem analysis strategy called TPCast. TPCast stands for title. What's the title of the text? Paraphrase. What is this poem about in your own words? Connotative. What is the poem implying? Any figurative language involved? Attitude or tone. What is the speaker's tone? What are their feelings about what they're writing about? Shift. Are there any changes in the speaker's attitude or tone from the beginning and the end? Title again. Take a look at the title. Now what do you think it means? Theme. What is the author trying to teach us? Seems like a lot, right? Especially since most poems are usually short. But poems usually help us think a little bit deeper about things using figurative language. Read along as I read the poem to you. Immunity by Kim Roberts. I don't really understand T cells, but when my doctor describes them, I imagine T's posted at intervals in my bloodstream, like sentries. At a crenellated wall, are they T-shaped? Or is T merely the first initial of a long, inscrutable Latin word? I see a line of cells holding shields. Emblazoned with T's, I hear the rhythmic chant, T, 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 T. As they fall into formation, for their regular bloodstream drills using TPCast. The title of the poem is called Immunity, and we know that by definition, an immunity is a defense system of our bodies using white cells to protect against diseases. Paraphrasing, let's put this in our own words, right? Sentries, a soldier stationed to keep guard. Crenellated, a wall prepared for battle. Inscrutable, impossible to understand. Emblazoned, to decorate with brilliant colors. T-cell, a type of white blood cell that is of key importance to the immune system and is at the core of adaptive immunity. Obviously, with the words that are being put out there, we should be getting a feeling of protection and safety. Like we said, our T-cells are about to go to battle. Attitude and tone. So this is where we get the feelings of the author. What do we think that Kim Roberts is thinking about when she's thinking about immunity? Shift. Was there any change in the attitude of the poem? Do you think the narrator has come to decide what T-cells and immunity actually are? Your call. Let's take a look at the title again, all right? Because we understand that immunity is a defense system. Don't we get the same idea with all the words that we've just been reading? Immunity is a way of protecting ourselves. And theme, what is the author trying to teach us? Well, with this poem, we would have a better idea of how our body has a natural defense system. Roberts uses the idea of an army of T cells as a representation about what our immune system does every time our body comes face to face with a disease. No matter how you interpreted the poem, it's important to know that our bodies are always and constantly finding ways to combat and fight diseases. You know who else is looking at finding ways to combat and defeat diseases? Our frontliners. Special shout out to our frontliners, the nurses, doctors, emergency medical practitioners, everybody. Thank you so much for all you are doing for our community. Ladies and gentlemen, that's really all I got for today. Ladies and gentlemen, stay safe, have a great day, and make good choices.
Hey everyone, it's Mrs. Palomo here, and today's topic is going to be on prevention. In the midst of this pandemic, it's important to avoid getting sick. So in this video, I'm going to discuss several ways you can avoid getting sick from common illnesses such as the flu or cold. I'm going to go over 6 preventive measures that can help you against the common illness. 1. Get your shots and vaccines. 2. Disinfect certain things in your household. 3. Practice good hygiene. 4. Take your vitamins. 5. Stay active. And 6. Get enough sleep. Let's begin with vaccines and shots. The Center for Disease Control and Prevention, or the CDC, recommends that you get your flu shot every year. Here are some videos to show you why vaccines are important as well as how they work.
You can find this video on the PBS Guam website and it's titled, Why Vaccines Work.
Vaccines work. Our immune system is on constant alert against germy baddies with millions of white blood cells, each on the lookout for specific infections. When an immune cell meets its target, it replicates itself, and this clone army sends a barrage of protein weapons called antibodies to label the trash for cleanup. And after the infection is gone, so-called memory cells stick around, ready to mount a fast attack in case this germ shows up again. This is how we develop immunity, and it works pretty well, you know, since we're all still alive. But even with all that, some super bad germs can take us out before our immune sentries have had time to call up their clone army. This is especially true for young children. Their immune systems are fresh out of basic training. Thankfully, we have vaccines, which are made of tiny pieces or weakened versions of viruses or bacteria. They let our immune system see what the bad guys look like and recruit those all-important memory cells before we ever have to actually see the real enemy. Thanks to vaccines, the US was able to eliminate measles in the year 2000. But in recent years, as more and more parents are refusing to vaccinate their children or are vaccinating them later than what doctors recommend, it's back. In most states, more than 90% of children are vaccinated, but that's not enough to keep a disease like measles at bay.
So remember, vaccines are important for your immune system because they can prevent you from catching illnesses.
Let's talk about cleanliness and disinfection.
Disinfecting things in your household can help slow the spread of sickness. When considering disinfectants, the CDC recommends 50 to 70% alcohol concentration. Disinfectants uses its chemicals to kill germs on surfaces or objects. By doing so, it lowers the risk of spreading infection. It is recommended that you clean and disinfect things that are touched a lot. These include light switches, doorknobs, touchpads, remote controls, and other high-touch items. When disinfecting or cleaning, it is recommended that you use disposable gloves. You are to discard them after cleaning. You can also use reusable gloves that should only be used for cleaning purposes. It is best to clean surfaces with soap and water before disinfecting. For electronic devices, you can refer to the instruction manual on how to clean them, or you can simply use a disinfecting wipe. It is also recommended that you wash your groceries. It's not safe to wash any fruit or produce with soap. Those that can be washed with soap should be washed with cold water. Now let's go over important vitamins.
The Cleveland Clinic Organization explains that there are three vitamins that help prevent sickness: vitamin C, vitamin B6, and vitamin E.
Vitamin C is very important. If you lack vitamin C, you're more prone to getting sick. They can be found in certain foods such as oranges, grapes, and bell peppers. Vitamin B6 affect the biochemical reactions to your immune system. They can be found in chicken and certain green veggies. Vitamin E serves as an antioxidant that can help fight infections. They can be found in nuts, seeds, and spinach. Now, about hygiene.
Hi, helpers. Do you know the best way to help your body stay healthy is to wash your hands? Wash your hands often, especially after going to the bathroom, before eating, and after blowing your nose. Use soap and scrub your hands while singing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star.
Let's move on to exercise and physical activity.
Staying active is always helpful for your body. Try to get 30 minutes of activity per day.
And finally, sleep.
Getting 8 to 10 hours of sleep is also good for your body. Here's a video that explains why sleep is important and how it can help your body.
This video is from the PBS Guam website and it's titled Sleep.
Hi, my name is Osvaldo. I go to Parma Middle School. And my question is, how does sleep help us?
Sleep is a third of our life. So the fact that it has been with us for millions of years tells us that it helps us to grow physically. It helps us to grow mentally and emotionally. It is the one thing that we cannot live without. And we need it on a daily basis, and we need it consistently. And we need to give it as much respect as we do exercise and good nutrition.
Hi, my name is April, and what happens if you don't sleep?
When we don't sleep or we don't sleep well, it can affect us in a lot of different ways. It can affect our learning. It can affect how we feel during the day. It can make us sad. It can make us grumpy. It can affect our memory. So not getting good sleep or not sleeping at all has a lot of effects that are not good.
Before we end today, here is guest speaker Zana Tagawa, who is a nursing student at the University of Guam.
Off a day, everybody. My name is Zana Tagawa, and I'm a student nurse at UOG. I'm here to talk to you guys about the three different ways to prevent sickness. The first one is good hand hygiene. The second one is flu vaccinations. And the third one is eating an adequate amount of fruits and vegetables. Okay guys, so with the first one, hand hygiene, it is very, very, very important to wash your hands. You have to wash your hands for about 15 to 20 seconds to make sure all the bacteria is off. You want to do this before you eat, after you play, after you use the restroom, and any time in between. Just wash your hands. I cannot emphasize it enough. And also, you want to use alcohol-based hand sanitizer. You can carry that around anywhere with you, especially during the coronavirus epidemic. That's good to do. Okay, everybody. Now, the second way to prevent sickness is to get the flu vaccine. Now, this is very important if you want to prevent getting the flu or any complications with the flu. Now, the CDC recommends everyone age 6 months or older to get the flu shot annually, and usually this is in October where the flu starts to peak. Now, lastly is to get a good amount of fruits and vegetables. Now, the rule of thumb is the more colorful your plate, the better. So fruits and vegetables helps to boost your immune system, which means it helps to fight off any cold or flu. Now, those are just three simple ways that you can prevent getting the sickness. I hope you guys enjoyed, and stay safe out there. Thank you.
All right, everybody, that's all the time I have for now. Goodbye.